Australian home values surged 2.1% higher in February, the largest month-on-month change in CoreLogic's National Home Value Index since August 2003, spurred on by a combination of record low mortgage rates, improving economic conditions, government incentives, and low advertised supply levels. Australia's housing market is in the midst of a broad-based boom. Let's get into all of the details with this month's market update. G'day guys, my name's Tim Guest and welcome to our Market Update video series where you can stay up to date with the markets that matter and find out what's happening in your local area. So housing values are rising across each of the capital cities and rest of state regions, demonstrating the diverse nature of this housing upswing. Now, according to CoreLogic's research director, Tim Lawless, a synchronised growth phase like this hasn't been seen in Australia for more than a decade. Now, Mr. Lawless said, the last times we saw a sustained period where every capital city and rest of state region was rising in value was mid-2009 through to early 2010, as post-GFC stimulus fueled buyer demand. Now, Sydney and Melbourne were amongst the strongest performing markets, recording a 2.5%, 2.1% lift in home values over the month, respectively, as Australia's two largest cities caught up from the weaker performance through 2020. Now, the quarterly trend, however, is still favouring the smaller cities. Darwin housing values rose 5.5% over the past 3 months. Hobart values were up 4.8% and Perth was up 4.2% over the last 3 months. Mr. Lawless said whether this newfound growth in Sydney and Melbourne can be sustained is unclear. Both cities are still recording values below their earlier peaks. However, at this current rate of appreciation, it won't be long before Australia's two most expensive capital city markets are moving through to new record highs. With household incomes expected to remain subdued and stimulus winding down, it is likely affordability will once again become a challenge in these cities. Now, regional markets up 2.1% over the month have continued to show a high rate of capital gain relative to the capital cities, only up 2%. However, the performance gap has narrowed compared to the earlier phase of the growth cycle. Now, regional areas generally record less of a decline in housing values through the worst of the COVID period last year, while also showing an earlier and stronger growth trend through the second half of last year. This regional preference is reflected in the annual growth trend, where the combined regional index is 9.4% higher, while the combined capital city index is up a much smaller 2.6%. Now, a housing market trend that has persisted through the COVID period to date is the weaker performance of unit markets relative to detached housing. Across CoreLogic's combined capital index, house values, which were 4.4% up over the past 3 months, have recorded a growth rate more than three times higher than that of its unit counterparts, only 1.4%. Although there are some tentative signs, this trend could become less obvious, with Sydney unit values recording their first month of growth since April last year, and April unit values recording their largest gain since late 2019. Now, one of the factors driving house prices higher is lower advertised supply levels. CoreLogic's most recent measure of total listing numbers continues to see advertised supply significantly below of recent years. Now, the number of properties advertised for sale nationally remained 26.2% below 2020 levels over the 28 days ending February 21. Whilst available supply remains at historic low levels, the quarterly number of home sales is estimated to be up over a third on 2020 levels, with regional dwelling sales 40% higher compared to a 32% lift in capital city sales. New listing numbers could see a more substantial lift in March, with CoreLogic's real estate platform data indicating agents are becoming more active. Now, historically, there has been a strong correlation between a real estate agent activity across the RP data platform and new listings, although about a two-week lag. Ms. Lawless said, although new listings are likely to track higher over coming months, if buyer demand continues to lift, it's likely advertised stock levels will remain low. Serious buyers would be well advised to have their financing pre-approved and be ready to act fast in order to secure a property under such tight supply conditions. Now, moving to rental markets across Australia, the disparity has been extreme. Now, at one end of the spectrum, we have extremely tight rental conditions in cities such as Perth and Darwin, where both house and unit annual rental growth is above 10%. At the other end of the market are the unit markets of Sydney and Melbourne, where rents have plunged over the last year, down just over 5% in Sydney and 8% lower in Melbourne. In a similar vein to housing values, rental markets are stronger with the detached housing sector relative to the unit sector. Mr. Lawless said the strength in Perth and Darwin's rental sector can be attributed to a mix of low supply due to recent history of low investor participation and rising demand as interstate migration trends move into positive territory. Now, the opposite trends in Sydney and Melbourne have seen rental markets weaken. Higher rental supply due to a recent history of investor exuberance, weaker demand from negative interstate migration, and more recently, a demand shock from closed international borders, where Melbourne and Sydney were the primary recipients of migrant arrivals. sales. However, the weak conditions across Sydney and Melbourne unit markets look to be turning. Sydney's rental index for units has recorded two successive months of mild rises, while Melbourne unit rents edged higher in February after falling for 9 of the previous 10 months. Weaker rental conditions in Sydney and Melbourne relative to rising home values is evident in the gross rental yields, with yields across both cities falling to fresh record lows in February. Gross rental yields in Sydney were recorded at 2.9% at the end of February, while in Melbourne, yields averaged 3%. For every other capital city, however, recording gross rental yields around the mid 4% mark or higher, implying positive cash flow opportunities, are more likely in these markets. Overall, Australia's housing market is now well entrenched in one of the strongest growth phases on record. For housing values and activity to be surging during a global pandemic seems counterintuitive. However, the factors driving this growth are significant and they are diverse. Record low mortgage rates, the lowest we've ever seen, look set to remain in place for a prolonged period of time, providing confidence to buyers, and historically low interest payments to income ratios. Economic conditions are consistently beating forecasts, with the RBA acknowledging Australia's economy is likely to recover 6 to 12 months earlier than originally expected. Now, the economic recovery is feeding into a solid rebound in consumer sentiment and encouraging households to reduce their savings buffer and spend more. Advertised supply remains at around record low levels at a time when buyer demand is rising swiftly above average levels. The mismatch between demand and supply looks set to remain a feature of the housing market for some time. There are some headwinds coming our way ahead in the form of a reduction in fiscal support from the federal government's support and home loan deferrals are also expiring while migration remains stalled. The intensities of these headwinds have lessened over recent months. The economy navigated the earlier fiscal cliff relatively seamlessly. However, the wind-up of JobKeeper and COVID supplement for JobSeeker is likely to cause a temporary slowdown in economic recovery and could slow some of the housing market exuberance. Similarly, there's been a substantial drop in deferred home loans, down from almost $200 billion, 11% of all home loans in May last year. APRA reported that $32 billion, or 1.8% of mortgages, were still in deferral at the end of January. As the deferral program expires at the end of March, we could see progressively a rise in forced sales across some sectors in the housing market. Housing price momentum looks to be skewed towards the upside, with the tailwinds of low rates, improved economic conditions and consumer confidence, low supply and high consumer demand are likely to outweigh the headwinds that are coming with the winding down of fiscal support. Guys, a lot to cover off today, but that's it from me today. Now, don't forget to like, comment and share this video, and don't forget to follow or subscribe wherever you're seeing this. Have a great week, and remember, there's only one thing in life that makes a difference, guys. That's action. Thanks a lot, and bye for now.